funded by the Broadcasting Authority of Ireland with the television licence fee.
Jenny, one of Blanchardstown's older, more colourful and well-known residents, has been living in the area for the past 34 years. Now 80 years of age, she lives independently in North Blanchardstown with her beloved animals. Four dogs, six goats and four horses. She, her dogs and buggy are a familiar sight around the shopping centre and the Blanchardstown area. This evening, Jenny is going to share with us her recollection of her life and times. Jenny was born in England in 1934. After the war, she lived for a period of time in Australia and Canada before returning to the UK.
My mother's people were all Irish, right? But my adopted grandmother had a school which she took down to Gloucestershire during the war. So we were all down in Gloucestershire. And the old Queen Mary used to come past and look at all the children, and everybody used to wave to her as she went past in the big limousine. She was up fairly regular looking at all the kids.
Well, why did she do that?
I don't know, because she's always liked children, apparently. She had six of her own, you know.
So this is the Queen's grandmother, is it?
That's the Queen's grandmother, yes. The paternal grandmother, her father's mother. She was Princess Mary of Teck before she married George V. And my adopted grandmother's sister was Lady Superintendent of a hospital for sick officers in the First World War in the house and the grounds of the Queen Mother's family, the Queen of England's mother's people. And she was commended after the war by George V. That's the First World War. Mm. And she used to have the Queen Mother and her title lady friends helping because they were short of nurses. And these girls were only 14, 15, 16, and they were brilliant because Auntie was a fully trained nurse in about 10 different branches of nursing. And she went to Australia after the First World War and nursed in the bush. You know, she had to go out the bush and everything. And she married, you see, and went out there with her husband. But anyway, we grew up going between Gloucestershire, Wimbledon and various other places like, you know, Hampshire and Torquay and Devon and Cornwall just to get away from the bombing. And I loved the New Forest. When I was nine, we went to the New Forest and the ponies came into our garden and my sisters put me up on the back of a horse and I made it do figure of eights in front of my mother on the lawn, and then the herd went off and the horse went off with me on it. So I had to wait for them all to pass me by, and then I rolled myself in a ball and rolled off him like I'd seen the pictures of the airmen coming down in their parachutes during the war. You know, we used to go to the cinema, you see. Didn't have television, had cinema. And after the war, we went to Australia, and I loved it. And I hated going back to England after living in Australia. I loved Australia.
Well, were you living in a place where there was a lot of military activity in your first home?
In Hampshire, there was, when we were going up and down between London and, Wimbledon and Gloucestershire, there was a lot of troops on the trains. That I do remember. So there must have been a base camp somewhere nearby. But there was a lot of troops all the time.
Well, Faisal is one of your
he's the
five
boss.
Goats.
Well, I nursed him through bronchial pneumonia as a kid. And now he thinks he owns me.
Well, he's certainly looking after you.
And one of my girl goats there I reared on a bottle from when her mother died. And so, I've done various things for animals over the years.
Well, tell us about Australia.
Loved Australia.
Was that the time when they were encouraging a lot of people from England to travel?
We went to school in Adelaide. I was 13 then when we went out. And we used to go riding around the parklands on horses, and we'd hire them like 4 shillings an hour, or I'd borrow a Palomino pony when I went down to Glenelg Beach and ride her along the beach. That was Nellie, and the owner of Nellie had trotting horses, and I was the first person to touch the yearling filly he had, and they took my photograph with Nellie and Lassie. It was great, that was. We used to go swimming and riding. We'd go out in my dad's motor sailor. And we used to go down to the koala bear farm. And I have held a koala bear. And the kids used to ride the Shetland ponies there. And when some of the lads tried to get in a Shetland pony called Skeeter, she was a white Shetland. like grey white, and little Blighter used to always throw them off. And nobody could ride Skeeter because she could whoop on her front legs, and away with them, they were gone. So that was a good crack, you know. I lived in Adelaide before it was built up entirely. The town of Elizabeth wasn't built then. I think Gawler was only just built. Because we lived on the road that leads up to Ayala. You'd go up this way and that way and then that way, and you'd be down to Ayala. So we were North Adelaide, but I went to school in a convent in South Adelaide. I could see the sea from where I was sitting in my schoolroom. It was lovely.
So you were probably educated by Irish nuns.
I was, yeah. What I did, a few times I went down to live in Gloucestershire. So I went to Berkshire at one stage and lived in a houseboat. And I got a mobile home, and I went down to Hampshire because I loved the New Forest, all the ponies and the wildlife. And, you know, it was...
They have special ponies down there, don't they?
Yeah, the New Forest ponies, yeah. Dartmoor's got special ponies too. One of our ponies we had as a child was a Dartmoor. We had a Dartmoor living in Wimbledon, and we had two Exmoors down the country at Granny School in Charfield in Gloucestershire. So I'm used to Moorland ponies. Like, you know, they're all special breeds.
She came to Ireland in 1980, having visited our shores during the 60s and 70s. Jenny is passionate about horses and animals, and in this excerpt tells us about her earliest involvement with animals.
So animals were always part of your life. It is a zoo in its own right. And I suppose you should mention where the zoo is.
Well, I lived down in the yard, Paris Town Road, in Mulhuddin, and I used to breed Arabians when I lived in Ballycoolan, and when I lived in Galway, but I don't have any anymore. Some were stolen on me, and my old mare died. And so now I just take in animals, like animals in need of help, horses, dogs, goats, you know. Years, even when I had Arabian horses, I took in sick, injured, and starving animals belonging to the locals.
And where would the Arabian horses come from?
Because when Granny died and left me some money, I bought my first Arabian mare.
Well, the Arabian mares are a very special breed, aren't they?
Oh, very special. And I bred some lovely animals out of a half Arab stallion of mine that was out of her. He was brilliant with children. Do you know, he'd turn his back on mares just to take the children out. He was never broken in. He trained himself, and he took the kids all over Blanchardstown. Ask the taxi man about him. Everywhere. All the children loved him. They'd come and queue up to get on his back. I've seen him go off with two kids at once on his back. And he'd never chase mares when he was with the children. And he'd turn his back on them. Well, he had three mares in the yard anyway, so he wasn't that bothered. And years before that, I had a purebred Arab stallion out of my second mare, and a half-bred Arab stallion. And those two boys were never separated, and they never fought. And nobody could believe I had two stallions that would never fight. And they lived with 10 mares. No fighting, ever.
The place that you live in now, when did you first come across it?
Well, I was living in Ballycoolan, and the council wanted me out there so they could redevelop it and ruin the best grass in County Dublin.
Well, would you not prefer the comfort of a house?
No, I'm better off in the caravan because I don't like stairs. I am a bit lame. And as long as I'm in a caravan, I don't have to walk up and down stairs. I'm on the same level. See, I couldn't manage a house.
So what about the other goats here now, talking about Faisal?
Faisal.
After King Faisal, is it?
Yes.
Well, indeed, he's a king in more ways than one, because yeah, he's taken over this place here.
Yes, and the fat golden one is a pedigree Anglo-Nubian, and his name's Hercules.
Which one is that?
He's the golden one with floppy ears.
And where'd you come across him?
He was given to me as a kid.
And do you have to, they're healthy animals, are they?
They are, yeah. Well, of course they're healthy. Why wouldn't they be? They get the best food. They get oats, they get horse and pony mix, which is cool and easy. They get chaff, they get alfalfa, they get bran, They get hay. They get everything. They get foal nuts for the occasionally as well. They get everything, both the horses and the goats, and the dogs get special game dog food.
And no fast food for your animals?
No, they get the best.
Now, you have a greyhound there also?
Yes, he was rescued. He walked into me bald, starving and mangy in the year 2010. And in 2009, I saved a horse of starvation, a pedigree thoroughbred.
So the diet is very important for animals?
It is very important, yes. Terribly important, yeah.
You never thought of getting the greyhound trained to do a bit of racing?
No, he was no good on the track. And he walked into me bald, starving and mangy 2010. And she was brought to me 2011. And I was landed with about 9 years ago, I was landed with a beautiful half chihuahua, fluffy things, pom. And she was stolen on me outside the yellow entrance of the Blanchardstown Centre one Saturday evening, the 2nd of April 2011.
That was a terrible thing to do on you.
Yeah, I had a Jack Russell robbed as well at the same time.
And Jack Russells aren't an easy dog to rob, I wouldn't think.
Yeah, well, you see, I had them in little boxes on top of my pram, which I used for pushing my shopping on. And what happened was, as I went down to get their pedigree chum, and somebody went and robbed them while I was down there. I was only gone 3/4 of an hour. They robbed them. And she was brought to me about January, February 2011. I've had her ever since. And I've had my old beagle donkey's years. She's 16 now. She was brought to me in the year 2000, bald, starving and mangy. And then I took in a half thoroughbred colt. He was in a bad way when he was brought to me. He's getting better. And the little miniature pony came to me walking like an old man as well.
Jenny receives assistance from various sources in taking care of our animals.
But of course, it costs me a lot of money. I'm only on the pension, so people give me donations, and sometimes they're not quite enough. But it's my bill is very high.
Well, I can understand that with the cost of pet food. It's very expensive.
Yes, yes. I've 5 dogs at the moment. I'm looking after a lurcher for a traveller. And I've got the beagle, and I've got the Samoyed. I've got a gorgeous collie who's very frightened of people. She's hiding under the caravan. So I've got the collie, the greyhound, the Samoyed, the beagle, and I'm looking after a traveller's lurcher pup.
And the collie, would she not be better off maybe down on the farm doing a little bit of sheep herding?
I don't think she wouldn't herd sheep.
Would she not?
No. She was brought to me by a farmer as a pup in a very bad way. Oh, and her brother was brought to me, and her brother died. I had her in the vets. Oh, I've never seen dogs in such a terrible state. They were really bad. But she's recovered, but she's very nervous because this thing bullies her. So they won't live in the same part of my mobile. I have a door dividing the two between the two. She lives in the living room with the others, and the collie lives in the back half.
That particular dog there... she looks like a husky.
She's a Samoyed. Yes, she's a Samoyed husky, yes.
So what country did they originate in? Do you know?
Alaska. They were part of the Inuit tribes, slave-pulling dogs. There's 3 of them. There's the Samoyed, the Siberian husky, and the Malamute. And they all come from the Inuit in Alaska, you know, where all the polar bears are and everything.
Yes.
That's where they come from. And the greyhounds originated in Egypt.
That's right. In some of the old paintings in Egypt, you see the greyhounds.
Yeah, they were the pet dogs of the pharaohs of Egypt. And in Arabia, they have what we call the Arabian greyhound. That's a feathery, hairy dog, but not too, very light feathered, you know, very dainty feathers. And they're beautiful, and they're the Arabian greyhound. They're called Salukis. And because they're Arabian greyhounds, when the Arab show is on in England, they have the Saluki show as well. So they go into the Saluki show. They have the Saluki show at the same time because they're Arabian dogs.
Well, the Arabian people, and Arabs, they don't race dogs, do they?
No, no. And the greyhound wasn't a racing dog originally. It was the pet dogs of the pharaohs of Egypt. It would hunt, but it wasn't raced.
Was there something sacred about the greyhound? Or am I thinking?
I think there was something like that. Yes, something like that. Because you see when you see pictures of Egypt, there are statues of greyhounds, and people don't take enough care of them here. They're terribly cruel to them here and in England. They don't take enough care of them.
Well, I think if a dog doesn't prove its worth on the racetrack, nobody wants them anymore.
Yeah, but they're sacred dogs of the pharaohs of Egypt. These are very ancient dogs. These are very elite dogs. They're one of the oldest breeds of dogs in the world. They should treasure them for their history.
And they're a gentle dog.
They are. Oh, they're couch potatoes. They love lying around. And because the greyhound blood is in the... what do you call them? Doberman dogs. They're also couch potatoes. I had a lovely Doberman stolen on me. She was brought to me in a bad way, and she was stolen later when I had her in good nick. And she used to like to lie on my bed. She was a couch potato too. They're very quiet dogs if you let them be.
And they have a reputation of being very vicious.
That's a load of rubbish. You couldn't have found a more gentle dog than mine.
So you think some of these animals get a bad press?
Yeah, Zita was very quiet. So well, what do you think of my animals?
I think they're lovely animals, and I'm fascinated by the goats in particular, because I can never make up my mind about goats.
Well, my goats think they're dogs, and they like my company. And if they can, they sneak in and sleep on my bed.
Well, do any of these goats milk, do they?
Well, we've been milking them lately, but I don't like goat's milk, so... I give them the milk to the lady whose child has the colt here, and she gives that to her dogs. They like it. My dogs and their dogs like it. So,
yeah. It's supposed to be very good for asthma.
It is, yeah. So I believe.
Yeah, I hear that. So tell me again about a little bit more about Australia. In Adelaide, was that an area where you had a lot of the original natives?
No, I wouldn't say so, because they'd be more out in the... in the middle of South Australia, near the sacred Ayers Rock, which they call Uluru.
So it was mainly settlers that you would be...
Well, mostly because that's how it was.
Jenny came to Ireland for a simple and quiet life, where she could follow her bohemian lifestyle.
I brought my child over from England. I got on the boat and came over. And that's it. And then...
So you had a child, a boy or a girl?
Girl. She's 46 now, and I have a granddaughter, 21.
And do you ever see them?
Well, not really, because I haven't seen them for about 5 years. My daughter lives in Spain. My granddaughter is studying business studies in England, and she goes between England and Zurich. Because she went to junior school in Zurich, and she prefers her friends in Zurich. She's fluent in German as well as English. So we don't, neither her mother nor I see her much.
Well, we might get in out of the rain, Jenny, for a moment.
Yes.
Well, you used to go to the Blanchardstown Centre. That's where we first saw you.
Yes, I still do. Yeah,
a lot of people would know you from up there.
Yes, I do.
That's where Charlie met you also up there.
Yeah, that's right. I always go up there, yes, every weekend. Well, I go up there when and have something to eat after I've been to get my pension, you know.
And did you notice any difference? You're around long before the Blanchardstown Centre was built, aren't you?
Oh, yes. In fact, I'll tell you something very funny. 1981, was it? No, the beginning of 82, when my mare still had a small foal on her, my... second Arab mare, right? She had the small foal. And when, you know, when the big high snow came in 82, they managed to get out of my yard that I had at Ballycoolan. And they ran away all the way down to where the centre is now. And they were all fields then. And that was actually the field that they ran away to. And I couldn't catch her for a fortnight. And then some young lads with a small child in a pram came and said they'd help me catch her. And they ran across the field with the child in the pram trying to catch my mare and foal. And we didn't catch her that day. I went down with carrots about 2 weeks later, and I caught her and brought them home. But that's where they ran away to. So my mare was actually on that land before the centre was ever built.
Looking back, Jenny has witnessed many changes in the area.
This used to be a beautiful place. The whole area was beautiful. Yeah. In 1980, there were fields and fields and fields. There was no Ladieswell. There was no Wellview. There was no Parsleckstown. And I had horses running wild. Frank Pennicott had horses running wild. It was a wonderful place. And cattle, they were running around as well. Frank's cattle. They could go around the whole area. There was no Castle Curragh. Nothing. There was nothing. And I came when the village of Ballycullen was just being disintegrated. But some of the villagers were there when I first came. So there's still some villagers left in these cottages, you know, on this road, you know, this road further along. And they're very nice people. And I was their nearest neighbor for a while. And then there was two other houses further the other way from me. And they were neighbours as well. And then there was another farmhouse, and there was some very nice people there. And in 1983, it kind of changed, you know, because the nice people kept selling and they sold to people that weren't very nice, you know. What?
They built the houses. No, the people who bought the land, did they?
No, no. What happened was... you know when you walk up the road where Cordoff is, and you go further up, much further up, right? There used to be, much further up, there was John Quinn's old farmhouse, and then you go up further and turn left, and then there was Sean Quinn's house, and then there was Queenie Healy's house. These were old farming families, you know. I knew them all. And then I had a yard across the road, and a drug-dealing builder chucked me out. And so I had my caravan at the side of a field, which the Quinns lent me on the corner of the road there for my horses. So that wasn't a problem. Like, that wasn't a problem. So, but it used to be beautiful. I didn't know this road very much, but there was nothing here. And all I know is about this land here, where I am now. That was farmed by Wilkinson, Mark Wilkinson. And he had corn right the way up to Wellview. And my horses ran away one time, and I remember seeing my stallion standing with the high corn right in the middle of the corn. He'd run away and stood in the middle of the corn. I was lucky Wilkinson didn't shoot him.
Corn is as high as an elephant's eye.
Exactly, yeah.
And the land, Wilkinson's land, from what I remember, went all the way down to Clonsilla, towards St. Joseph's there in Clonsilla.
Yes, but wait a minute. There was another family owned the land. You know where Parsleckstown is, and Parsleckstown House? That belonged to another family. Sheila Baker and her two children lived in the big house there, Parsleckstown House. My daughter used to ride my Arab mare from Ballycullen Cross all the way down to play with the children belonging to Sheila Baker. And they had a small pony as well. And all that land now, then Sheila died, and the brother took the children and sold the land to the council. And they left everything open, so everybody's animals were able to go there. And the man in charge of pounding the horses would never pound mine. He'd pound anyone else's, never pound mine. He said mine were looked after, because they were always fed, you know. I didn't just leave them on grass, I fed them as well. So mine were always fed. They looked it too. But, it was a beautiful place. And then I remember them starting to put the foundations of Wellview, no, Ladieswell. And my stallion was a bit puzzled because there was always a certain point he used to bring the mares across the road into Parsleckstown, right? And he was a bit puzzled by all these square things going up. And so he had to start bringing them across the road further up, and he wasn't best pleased. He was my purebred stallion. He was the chief boss of all the horses. He was the boss of everyone.
How many mares did you have then?
I had I had my mare, Namaqua. I had a filly daughter. That was Shaquilla Ben Shamel. Then I had Royal Eclipse, who was older than Shaquilla. And I had a noble mandarin, a half-bred from one of her runaway romances by a spotted horse. That was a noble mandarin. And so they all ran out with Frank's horses. He had stallions as well. But none of the stallions ever fought because they were all reared together. I used to look after Frank's horses as well as my own. So they were all reared together. They all ran together. There was no problem. If I wanted a purebred foal, I just took my mare to a purebred stallion and kept her away until she was well in foal, and then got her back, you know. But some years she'd have purebreds, and some years she'd do what she liked. And Frank was telling me before he died that some of the foals he had from my purebred stallion out of his mares were fantastic.
Jenny, just in terms of your 34 years here in Ireland now, and in terms, what is the biggest change you've seen?
I think there's too much growing up of houses. I think so, yeah. And the fact is that people now, the kids are getting all mixed up in all these criminal activities and drugs and everything. It's not nice. I don't like that because we never had that when the children were young years ago. When I first came to Blanchardstown, there was none of that. The kids used to all come up and ride my horses. They rode my old mare. And even some of the biggest villains in Cordoff now, they remember my old mare. And so, you know, she was special to them, you know. But when the drug barons moved in from Finglas, they ruined all the young people. They did, really.
I think that's a worldwide phenomenon, unfortunately. But do you think animals bring out the best in people?
Yes, I do. And one of the lads who used to keep his pony with me and rode my horses and came up here, he won many races, grew up and won many races in Australia and America. He's now a trainer in America. His name is Mark Phillips. And then Gary Halpin came from a very bad family in Ladieswell, and he has gone away from his family and got trained at the jockey school, and he's now winning races here. And another lad that used to be up with my horses, he has done groom for several training establishments for horses. And another lad who was too heavy to be a jockey has worked twice for Mactoom down in Kilcock, George Douglas.
Well, I suppose a lot of the people living in the area don't realise that this was a very big horsey area anyway in the old days.
It was, yes, it was, definitely. This was probably part of the Ward Union country. Yes, it was. Very big area.
Yeah, we had a number of studs over by Wilkinson's land there at the back of St. Joseph's, between St. Joseph's and Clonsilla and Clonee.
The Ongar. That's now built on Ongar, yeah.
And Bulger, I think, had a stud.
Bulger, yeah. Jim Bulger, he moved to the country after somebody set fire to his stables.
That's right.
Wait a minute. Another builder, can't think of his name at the moment. You know, right in Clonsilla, there was a gateway and you go into his stud there, in the corner, on a corner of a road. And it was sort of like a corner of the road. And straight into Clonsilla High Street, I can't think of the name of the man, he was a builder. He's moved out now. I think he's gone down to County Meath. Name begin with L, I think.
Lynham?
Yes, that's him. Racehorses.
Well,
and I know the Keeneys who used to breed and race horses. I think Johnny still does. And Joan breeds race horses up in Kildare now. She's married, so she's not living at Little Pace anymore. She lives up in Kildare. And she bred a horse called Just the Judge, a female horse called Just the Judge. And she sold it. And Just the Judge was won a race or something, and she became Breeder of the Year or something. One stage, or Breeder of the Month or something. She's got a lovely mare.
If I could talk to the animals, just imagine it, chatting with a chimp and chimpanzee. Imagine talking to a tiger, chatting with a cheetah. What a neat achievement it would be.
If we could talk to the animals, learn all their languages, maybe take an animal degree, I'd study elephant and eagle, buffalo and beagle, alligator, guinea pig and flea.
You've got horses, then you need people like blacksmiths.
Oh yes, well, my blacksmith is Jim Flanagan.
So where would he be located?
He lives near Kilsaligan.
I know it. It's just the reason I ask you is you don't see a forge anymore.
No, but Jim comes round in his little red car and he trims my filly's feet, the red and white one. The others aren't old enough yet, but he trims her feet. And my vet is Vertoth Veterinary, Con Kennedy's place. They're very good.
What happens if you don't trim the feet?
Well, they could go curling upwards and make them very lame and sore, very bad. So Jim only charges me £20 a time to trim the feet.
That's odd.
Because she doesn't need shoes. She's not broken in. And we don't do road work, so she doesn't really need them. Mm-hmm. And I never shod my Arabs. I used to ride them and never shoe them. And of course, Arabs got very good feet. Now.
And in their own environment, the Arab steeds, would they be shod? No.
Because mostly they'd be going on sand anyway. No, I never heard of them shoeing with their horses' feet ever.
What is it about the Arab steeds and their temperament?
Well, the stallions are usually much quieter than most horses, you know. They're just very easy to manage. I've never had a nasty Arab stallion or even a nasty mongrel stallion. In my yard, ever. I never had a problem with the stallion. The only horse I ever had a problem with was a greedy gelding that knocked me down and dislocated my arm last year. But I never had a trouble with the stallion. They're usually very polite. As long as you don't hit them around the face, because they have very bad trouble with their teeth all their life. The eye teeth give them many trouble, and people will keep hitting them around the face, and they make them savage. I wouldn't let anyone hit a horse of mine around the face. So my stallions in my yard were always very quiet, very easy.
When you were injured that time, did you have to...
I went down to the hospital and got it put back and walked out of the hospital at 4 o'clock in the morning. They said they wouldn't let me sleep, so I went, good night, and I left. That's it. And that was only last year. I'm very tough anyway.
And do you still go down to the Blanchardstown Centre?
Every weekend, yes. Every Friday and Saturday.
Ah, right.
Yeah. Every Friday
and Saturday. Do people stop and talk?
They do, yeah. Oh, yes, they do. And they tell me about their dogs and their parrots. And, you know, I have a good bit of crack. And, you know, it's good fun. Mm-hmm. And, you know, Mitzi comes down with me mostly. Occasionally I take... Adam, that's my greyhound, Adam, he comes down sometimes. But if he sees dogs, he roars and shrieks and shouts. And if I tie him up while I'm going in to get some shopping, he roars and screams until I come out. And she doesn't make a big row about things. She does bark at other dogs sometimes, but she doesn't make a big fuss. She comes into town with me on a Saturday night. She's my guardian on Saturday, so nobody will interfere with me with her there.
And where do you come into, or where do you come by all the names? How do you think up these names?
Well, Mitzi. That's Mitzi. She's Mitzi Gaynor. That's Adam. And that's Tiger. He was named when I got him. That's Dorina. And my colleague is Suey after, you know that man from Australia Zoo that got killed? He had a dog called Suey. S-U-I.
Steve,
yeah.
Wasn't it? Steve,
yeah, Steve Irwin, yeah. So I called her Suey.
So, would you have liked to have worked in somewhere like a zoo?
I have worked in circuses. I worked for Bertram Mills. I did, and helped with circus human horses. Oh, yes, I did. I worked with stallions before I ever had a mare. Right. Arab stallions, Lipizzaners, half Arabs and half Lipizzaners. And it was lovely. I used to take them to the ring and help with them.
And was Bertram Mills, was that a stationary circus? Or
no, no, they toured. They toured, yes, yes. And when they were in the north one time, a very naughty zebra called Nairobi went out and had a big romance with Can-Can the donkey, and they had a foal the following year.
What was the result like?
Oh, Derry was bold. He was the boldest thing on four legs. He'd always be lunging at the goats and the rabbits and the next pen in the menagerie at the Olympia. He was very nasty to them. Well, Nairobi was very cheeky. Very cheeky zebra she was. And the groom let me go in with the zebra stallion one time. His name was Masai. And you know what they do? They put you in a corner, a zebra stallion will, and like a bull, knee you into the corner and then turn around and whammy me with their back legs. That's why I have to be very careful of a zebra stallion.
And how did you get involved with the circus in the first place?
I went and asked for a job there. And I was the only...
Simple as that.
Yeah, and I was the only girl allowed in the stables. Bernard Mills was in charge of the animals. And my first mare was a daughter of one of Bertram Mills' circus stallions. Her father was Azan. A-Z-A-N, Azan.
And does that circus still exist?
No, they gave it up. Both Schumann's and Bertram Mills gave up their circuses because it wasn't financially viable. And they both had big estates, Bertram Mills in Berkshire and Schumann's in Denmark. And they had a discussion, decided it wasn't viable because, I mean, they fed their animals like kings, you know. That's why I don't like circuses around here. None of them know how to feed a lion or a tiger or how to feed a horse or anything. See, I was taught how to look from them. I learned how to feed them the best.
The circus that used to be permanent in Blackpool, what one was that?
Oh, the Blackpool Circus. I think Norman Barrett, one of us ringmasters, went to work there after Bertram Mills closed, yes. And I think they had some of our animals as well at one stage. When I was at the Olympia, they used to borrow a giraffe called Happy from a Chessington Zoo. And Happy used to kiss me all around my face when I gave her sugar, so I had a sugary face. And one year, Roger Corley put a lion cub into my arms in his office. And then the last circus, end of the last circus season at Olympia, some zoo boys came from Chessington to collect the tiger Oscar, and they hurt his arm. They were very nasty and very rude to the lads in the menagerie. So one Scottish lad came up and fetched me, and we ended up stroking Oscar's paws, and I fed him meat and milk, and the meat that Oscar had to eat was better than what millionaires have on their dinner table. Because Bertram Mills' animals, you want to see the meat, better than any millionaire would have on his table. And you see, people don't feed their tigers like that, not anywhere else. I never seen them. I never seen or heard of them in any circus around here, or any. Not many zoos would feed them to that height, like, you know, the best.
That must have been a great privilege, having the lion cub in your
arms. Oh, it was wonderful. Her name was Sally. She was named after the girl that Norman Barrett married, and that was the year they got married. I think that was 66. I think it was 66. That was just before I had my daughter. My daughter was born in 67. So,
did you settle down then when your daughter was born?
No, I did not. I bought my first Arab mare as a foal, the daughter of one of Bertram Mills' circus stallions. And he was at stud at Mrs. Forehead's farm. And when I went down to buy Priory Petronella, she rang Jock Morrison, who used to be our old stable master of Bertram Mills, and said, was I a suitable person to have the foal? And he said, yes. So they sold it to me, €600. And then I reared her, and I bred Namaqua out of her. And Namaqua's father was the son of the Queen of England's Royal Jordanian mare. The Queen of England didn't like Jordanian horses much, not Arabs. She sent her Arab mare over to Mrs. Nicholson, her cousin over here. And Mrs. Nicholson was looking for a stallion for her, and she met Mrs. Roberts. So they married the two, and as a result of that was a stallion called Genjo, and he was sold to Dr. Blake of Jamolka Park, Old Town Athlone. When he was five and my mare was about five, they met up. I went down to see him. I had Priory Petronella over here at the time. I went down to see him. Oh, yes, he said. And he came and fetched her, married her off, and I took her back. And then I took her back to his place when I was coming to Dublin. So she ran out with Genjo. And Namaqua was born on a Friday at 11:30 in the morning.
When you say run out, what does that mean?
Well, I ran them out. They were running out in the field, weren't they? So I got Namaqua out of that. Namaqua by Genjo at a priory Petronella.
And going steady, is that the...
They were going steady, yeah. They were going steady. And then Namaqua lived to 26 and a half years. Priory Petronella was killed by a faulty electric pole belonging to the Corporation of Dublin when I was riding back from Merrion Beach one day, coming down the Merrion Road. And they had a leaky pole and there was a bit of water there. And she dropped dead under me. She was 10 and a half. And I cried for 4 months because I'd read her with a child. And Namaqua, she was a bit upset as well. Then we later, thank God, moved down here. So,
but did you not think that when your daughter was born that you'd have to settle down?
No. I when she was 18 months, I went to live on a farm down in the Hampshire. And I took Priory Petronella down there. I got a half Arab stallion with bad eyes. I had him. And I never broke him. I just was able to sit on his back and walk around on him. And gradually I taught him about a saddle and bridle. And my child could go up to him. She was only, must have been barely two. She grabbed him by the head collar one day, said, "Cowan, groomies, groomies, groomies," and banged his legs with a grooming brush. And Cowan just did this, hung his head like that, and just stood there like an elderly horse. And he was only two. And I got a pony for her. That was a sugar bulldozer. And then I had already bought a cream blue-eyed mare that I went shopping on. She was part Arab, and we went shopping on her. I used to go shopping with the child in front of me and down to the shops. We lived 2.5 miles away. I used to go down to the shops and come back with the shopping in front of me and the child and come home. And then when I got the pony, I used to take her on the pony, put the shopping in front of me and ride Omo down to the shops.
And did the daughter take onto horses like you did?
No, she's more into pussycats and dogs. She rescues dogs and cats in Spain.
Does she?
Yeah, pussycats. Mostly pussycats.
What part of Spain is she in?
Mojica, in Andalusia.
But so, that's another good horsey place, isn't it?
I don't know about that, but she occasionally takes in dogs in trouble, in pups in need of help and everything. Mostly the cats, though.
So you passed on your love of animals to your daughter?
Well, I wouldn't say she loves them. No, she's much more middle class. And she'd have a fit if she saw this place. "You're dirty and disgusting. You destroy everything you have," she says to me. "You're disgusting."
Did she ever visit?
Oh, last time they came, I think it was 2005 or something. And my granddaughter was about 11. My granddaughter's 21 now.
Would you like to see them again?
Well, if they come over, yeah. Fine.
Would you have no interest in going over?
Well, I haven't the money to go over to Spain, and I'd have to pay people to look after the dogs and the goats. If I go to Spain or go to England to the Arab show, the dogs have to go into kennels. And that's £300 for a start. And what I usually do when I have only goats in the yard, I just leave them a roll of hay if I'm going away for a week. And I never go for more than a week, ever.
A four-legged friend, a four-legged friend, he'll never let you down. He's honest and faithful right up to the end, that wonderful one, two, three, four-legged friend. A woman's like cactus, and cactus can hurt, cause she's just a tight-waisted, winky-eyed flirt.
And the goats are easy to look after, are they?
Well, yeah, they are, but my goats are used to oats and horse and pony mix and hay, like chaff and alfalfa and hay and everything. They're used to being fed like racehorses. They'd have a fit if somebody took them on and didn't feed them. By the way, I'm sort of a member of the goat club down in Meath, down in Trim, and the head of the goat club is very good. He comes and helps me. He gave me these two settees, and he helped to fix my door that fell off, and my hall door, and he gave me the Anglo-Nubian goat and the Toggenburg.
So there's a goat club. I never knew that.
Yeah, down in Trim, yeah. And he's on the committee of the Royal Meath show. So when the Royal Meath show comes on September, first Sunday in September, I'll be going, hopefully go down there this year and see it.
Well, there's Meath is a great county for hunting. Would you be in favour of hunting?
No, I'm not exactly in favour of hunting.
But I'm talking about maybe the out hunting, not so much after animals, but just chasing the fox.
I don't believe in chasing the foxes the way they do. I have a pet fox. Well, it's not a pet fox. He's a wild fox that lives in the field. And he comes in if it's bad weather and sleeps with the goats in their caravan, never interferes with kids' goats or anything else. And there's a wild cat goes into the small caravan sometimes. If I go out in the middle of the night to check on the animals for any reason, if the girls are kidding or anything, I might find the odd... those animals at odd times in there.
And the fox wouldn't run away when he sees you, no?
Well, I sat down and looked at him and he didn't really know what to think and he didn't particularly like me as a human being looking at him, so he ran. But I didn't do anything to frighten him. Just sat there. I was amazed, you know, to find living there together.
With all the animals you have, Jenny, do you get help with the feeding of them? I know you've a lot of hay out there.
No, I go out and people give me donations and the family that have the colt, they do come down and help me now. But last winter, I came through the winter with 6 goats, 2 horses and 4 dogs and no help. And I was out in all weathers and I used to go into town to visit my friends up at Legs Nightclub and I'd get donations and I'd come home. I go out every Saturday and I walk from Trinity up to Leeson Street every Saturday. I'm 18.
So you go to the nightclub strip?
I go up to, yeah.
They know you up there.
Oh, they do, yeah. I get a cup of tea and a sandwich and whatever. I'm treated like royalty. I don't like going inside them. I never dress up and I don't like going inside them because when you go into these places, it's very crowded and it's very claustrophobic and it's underneath the ground, you know, so I prefer not to dress up. I prefer to go stay outside and have a chat with everybody outside.
Yeah.
So Mitzi and me are regulars up there. And she's a regular on Saturday down at the centre. And she has chicken nuggets from beef burgers. And if she's not with me, they want to know where the white dog is, because she always comes and sits between the two dogs, waiting for her chicken nuggets.
So people are very good, really?
Oh, there's a lot of very nice people, yes, very nice people.
And what do you think is going to happen, God forbid the time, when you're not able to look after the animals anymore?
Well, if anything happens to me, the DSPCA man's very good. He'd come and look after them because they've got a very good man with goats and dogs and everything. PJ's marvellous with goats and horses and things. And the man from the goat club would take goats if I'm stuck. You know what I mean? And my dogs and the horses would be all right down at the DSPCA. There's a man there called PJ and goats just absolutely love him. He's brilliant. Like, he's brilliant with horses too. And he's good with animals, you know.
So the DSPCA, you get on very well with them, do you?
Well, they actually have been very good to me. They bought me food at odd times and a couple of rugs for the horses in the winter and everything, you know. I do know them. One of their DSPCA men I've known for a while, and the other DSPCA man I've known since he was our dog warden here. And he left the council, back to the council, and went to work for the DSPCA. And when Liam Kinsella had his sister-in-law robbed some years ago by some horrible person at Christmas. I had a very nasty dog at the time, a half fox, right? And I called him Henry Fox. Right, says I, you're going to take Henry Fox and his son. And I said, I guarantee they'll never be robbed again. And he took Henry Fox and he took his son. And he told me later that even he couldn't enter the house, Henry Fox would be at him. Now, what do you think of that? And I'd given him the dog, and he couldn't enter his sister's house.
It sounds like a good mix.
It was a great
for a watchdog.
Oh, Henry was absolutely brilliant. He, He did. He absolutely, I think he saved their bacon. You know it. So that was some years ago. I think Henry Fox is dead now. Don't know what happened to his son. But while he was there, oh, he was brilliant. Nobody could enter their house. Something had to be done.
Well, do you think dogs in modern homes should be out in kennels in the gardens?
No, I think that they should live in like mine do. They should have their choice.
You think they're a house animal, do you?
I think that sometimes some dogs like to live in the house, some like to live out. Now, my colleague very seldom come in. And sometimes now I've caught Mitzi going into the small caravan. I let them do what they like. I have kennels outside, they can do what they like. They come in if they want to. If they want to sleep in, they sleep in. I think it's up to the dog. And I think a dog should have the choice. And I think there should always be a dog door in the house so the dog can decide whether it wants to go out in a kennel or whether it wants to come into the house or what it wants to do. And also, if a dog door's in somebody's house, it's safer in case of fire or accident. They can get out in a hurry, you know, and they can do what they like. I think animals should do what they like. I mean, I wouldn't tell my dogs, you must stay in or you must go out.
You think they're a free spirit?
I think, well, animals are free spirited, aren't they? They don't like to be constrained.
You're a free spirit yourself.
I suppose, in a way, I never lock my horses in, and that's why... when the council put me here, I demanded two containers that could be left open. Because when I had Arabs, they hated being locked in. So I never lock an animal in, and never horses. They go in and out as they please. I never lock animals in. If they want to go in the sheds, go in. If they want to go out, go out. And my old mare and Flashella, they don't like going into anything. They, even in the winter, they go up to the woods. They like the woods.
You mentioned earlier on when you're breaking a horse... What's involved in doing that?
I never had to really break a horse. They just do what they want to do.
No, but you know, breaking them for a saddle.
Well, my mare's so quiet. Kids have been sitting on her back and leading her around for about a year. She's only three, and I haven't put a saddle on her yet. But years ago when I had Count Royal, I just sat on his back at first, and then I taught him to wear a saddle. By that time, he was used to me on his back anyway, so it didn't make any difference. And I think when animals get used to people on their back, when they've had a rug on them, like my mare had last winter, Flashella had last winter, they don't mind if you put a saddle on because it's just like putting another rug on them.
Well, you must have lived through the times when the bread man, the milkman, and other tradesmen had their horse.
Oh, yes. When I was a child in Charfield, we had a milkman with big churns, and he'd come round in a trap and deliver the milk. And I always used to like to drive his horse down to the weir, and that's how I learned to drive a horse. I used to drive it, and then I'd get out at the weir and walk back.
He'd have a kind of a pony and trap, wouldn't he?
Yes, it was a pony and trap, and he had a big jug, and you'd take the jug out of the churns and you'd ladle it into your own jugs.
Would he give you another drop for luck? Was that
the I don't know what he... I know that Auntie used to come out and get the milk. Or we had a lady working for us. She was Irish. Maybe Mary would come out and get it, you know. But he was very nice. And then when I went back to London after the war, when we first went back to London, we had a milkman. They also had a pony named Tommy. But he used to deliver milk as well in bottles, you know. And then they got these horrible electric things after that.
Little electric ones, wasn't that right?
Yeah.
They came after the horse.
Yes.
And cart.
They were horrible. I preferred it when... I used to love it when the horses used to come up with the milk and with the various things. It's much better.
But there were different times, and you can't expect to stand still, I suppose.
No, but I was reared in those times, you know.
But a lot of us remember those times.
Yes. Probably. Well, one thing, I came visiting Ireland in 63, I went to Dublin. In 66, I went down the country. And I stayed on a farm for a week, and a new calf was born there, and they had another calf 3 months old. And I was delighted to see that they didn't take the calf away after a week. In England, they were shipping their calves away from the mothers after a week. That's not nice. This man was a marvelous farmer, and he had a lovely calf, 3 months old, and another calf born while I was there. And they stayed with their mas. I don't think it makes much difference to the milk supply. I would never take kid goats off a mother if I wanted to milk her. Instead of milking twice a day, I'd milk them once a day and leave the babies feed as well. There's no problem.
But they breed the young calves and they're revealed, don't they?
Yes, I suppose they do, but I haven't seen so much veal of late. I think there was a big row about the way calves were treated, and so they put a stop to a lot of the veal. You're not allowed to have veal now. Oh, very rare here of veal would do now these days.
No, I think they sell the cattle quite young now, a year and a half.
They do,
that's,
yeah.
That's what they want. Butchers want the lean meat now. They don't want the
that's
meat
right.
with muscle anymore.
No, they don't, no. But, well, the quietest bulls you can ever get are Herefords, white-faced Herefords and Shorthorns. Because I was living in a field before I came here, up in Ballycoolan, right? And for a while I was on my own there, and Kit Connors had cattle in there. Five of them were bulls, Shorthorns and white-faced Herefords. And I used to have to walk home. There was no pavement, so you take your life in your hands walking on the road at night. So I go through the field, five bulls in the field and a gang of cows, and it was Kit Connors' daughter who used to come and feed them. She'd come in with the tractor and feed them. And they were as good as gold. And I remember one day I woke up and I heard a lot of snoring going on. I opened my door and saw a big red bull lying like this outside the door, snoring his face off. And another wicked-looking sort of half-Charolais type rubbing his horns against my caravan. And the caravan was a mobile. It was going like this a bit. But the one outside, the big, huge big bull, lying there, wholly relaxed, snoring his face off. So funny. That I remember. That was really great. And since then, they've ruined that field. It's the field in front of the IT college. They've ruined it. There was a lovely stream there. They made it a pond now. My mare used to drink at that field, stream, because that was the field. It's a beautiful field.
But you've still a lot of countryside around you here.
Some, yes, if you walk down the road, yeah.
I mean, when you walk down this road you're on, you think...
Well, half this road is County Meath anyway. You go a couple of bridges down, that's County Meath. So I am on the borders of Meath here.
So where do you see yourself going from here? Nowhere, I suppose.
Nowhere, no.
You want to stay here?
Yeah, I suppose so.
Just reflecting back on all your years, is there anything that you feel that people today could learn from your life experience? Anything that you would...
Well, I think...
A bit of wisdom you'd offer.
I don't think they look after their animals properly enough, and if they did, they should rear their children with animals that teach them a bit of humanity.
So do you think that anyone that loves animals, that they'd be a good human being?
Yeah, I think they're okay, yeah.
And you wouldn't trust anyone that hates animals?
No, I would not. not very much. You don't hate animals, do you?
No, I don't.
No. Well, no, I wouldn't. There'd be something wrong with them. But, my father liked animals, and I was a disabled child, and he used to make me go and feed and groom and muck out the pony one-handed. My left side was no good. And I learned to bridle and saddle one-handed, and I learned to ride a horse, and... I ended up feeding the chickens and ducks as well, and the others were supposed to help me, my other sisters, and they didn't. But we had chickens and ducks as well when I was young.
I don't see any chickens around here.
No, I don't have any. I was reared with 100 of them, and two horrible white Leghorn cockerels used to peck us.
And well, the goats would probably eat all the eggs in them anyway, wouldn't they?
I'm not sure. I think it would be more like the dogs. I think that they like eggs.
Well, Jenny, it's been great talking to you. And thanks for your hospitality.
My Name is Jenny was written and produced by Charlie Kurtz and Chris Hitchcock. Editing by Shane O'Neill.
Funded by the Broadcasting Authority of Ireland with the television licence fee.